This video is brought to you by my wonderful patrons. So, John Horgan has appointed the official cabinet of the new NDP government. Let's talk about that. First of all, let's acknowledge that there are lots of reasons that someone might be appointed to a cabinet position. We generally tend to think that it all has to do with skill and experience. This guy makes cupcakes for a living. He's the Minister of Cupcakes. This gal has a master's degree in speedrunning. She's the Minister of Video Games. And that certainly plays a part, but there's also a lot more that Horgan has to consider when selecting his ministers. He has to make sure it's balanced. If every single minister was from a riding on the island, that is not fair representation. He could, but it would be unwise. Instead, he should distribute the geographic representation as much as he can. It also has to be gender balanced. The population is 50-50, so should the cabinet, or at the very least, his elected caucus is 44-46, so it should be 50-50 plus or minus one. And Emily's riding can also get them a cabinet position. If your riding produces 80% of all the dragons, or you're the only NDP MLA that represents a dragon-producing riding, then you should probably be the Minister of Dragons, even if you yourself don't have experience with them. If your party campaigned on stopping princess abductions, and that's a real problem for your riding, you might just be appointed to the ministry best suited for dealing with that issue, because it affects your riding so much. If your riding has almost always been won by the Liberal Party by a large margin, and you happen to win it in this election for the NDP, you might also get a cabinet position, even if you have zero experience. This is to assist you in building your portfolio and name power, in order to help you have a better chance of securing that rare seat for your party in the next election. If you've been elected 3, 4, 5 times in a row, then you probably know what you're doing, and would probably be pretty competent in most any ministry. And so you might just get appointed based on your experience in politics, rather than your experience in the ministry's field. And finally, just remember that a minister has an entire ministry behind them. They don't have to be an expert. They just have to be a good leader, who's competent at their job, and is willing to care and get shit done. Alright, now that super bloated introduction is over, who's who, and what's what, and who's what, and what's who? As opposed to the 2013 Liberals' 19, the NDP have 20 cabinet ministers, plus John Horgan. This means that with 41 MLAs, more than 50% of the elected party has a cabinet position. This is probably the highest ratio that we'll see in a long time, considering that this is a pretty big cabinet for a pretty small minority government. Oh, and it also has a perfect 50-50 gender representation. Let's talk leadership. John Horgan is the premier. Just like the prime minister, he's the first, or number one minister. He leads the government and also the cabinet. His second in command, the deputy premier, is Carol James, from Victoria Beacon Hill, who's also the finance minister. She was the leader of the party from 2005 to 2011. John Horgan was, and still is, one of her greatest supporters, so along with her experience, it makes sense that he would appoint her to deputy premier, where, in Horgan's absence, she would take over his duties. She has extensive experience working in education and mental health, but not much in the way of finance. Finance is one of, if not the most important ministry. The work done there influences all the others. So perhaps this decision is more of a, I trust you, and we're on the same page with what we're trying to accomplish, and I want you to help lead, sort of thing. Which makes sense. And again, the ministry itself will be filled with experts, so that's not what the minister is necessarily for. The Liberal minister, for instance, had a law degree, not economics or finance or any other similar education. Another really important position is the Attorney General. Technically, it's not like a real leader of the cabinet, but it's the only position where one kind of sort of influences the legislative, executive, and judicial branches of government. They're the elected official that oversees the legal branch of government, as well as things like campaign and election laws, like campaign finance reform and proportional representation. They even oversee things like ICBC. For this position, Horgan has appointed David Ebby of Vancouver Point Grey, who is an adjunct professor of law at UBC and an award-winning lawyer, which is apparently a thing? From his bio on the government website, he's noted for his work on constitutional and administrative law issues related to the protection and promotion of human rights and democratic freedoms. So, he's got this. Let's talk geography. As far as the popular vote goes, the NDP and Liberals are basically tied. But as far as landmass, the NDP got slaughtered. They did get almost all the coastal ridings in most of Vancouver Island, and they got quite a lot in the denser areas of Metro Vancouver like the Burrard Peninsula and Northwest Surrey. And they even got Maple Ridge. But the interior? Almost nothing. The Kootenays are doing okay, but Okanagan? Zero. Thompson River? Zero. Caribou? Zero. The North? Decent, but Peace River? The zeroest zero. Which I think says a lot about the Sightsea Dam, by the way, when the two Peace River ridings, the most liberal ridings in the province, vote even more liberal than normal. They haven't voted like this since the 80s. The next closest thing was in 2001 when the NDP didn't even get official party status, and the Liberals still got less votes then than they did this election. I'm just saying. There are lots of reasons that you might not support Site C, but if you're arguing that the people there don't want it, you're just looking at anecdotal evidence, and honestly, lying to yourself. Anyway, looking at this map, can you guess who got cabinet positions? Yep, you guessed it. All three interior representatives. Doug Donaldson of the Sakeen Riding is the Minister of Forest, Land, Natural Resource Operations, and Rural Development. He's worked as a biologist in forestry and in initiatives focusing on economic development in his rural communities. He and his riding suit this position very well. Katrine Conroy of Kootenay West is the Minister of Children and Family Development. Her responsibilities would include working on the new $10 a day childcare and working on a better system for those aging out of government care. This is her fourth time being elected, so surely she's competent and she's a parent, I guess? Finally, Michelle Mungel of Nelson Creston is the Minister of Energy, Mines, and Petroleum. This is a very interior-centric ministry, dealing with things like the Site C Dam and LNG, so it kind of had to go to one of these three. This is her third term, and before that, she was a city councillor, and she oversaw lots of varying organizations going as far as Zambia, so I'm sure she'll do great here. This also leads us to the Ministry of Environment and Climate Change Strategy, which will work on issues like the Kinder Morgan pipeline and oil tanker traffic. They'll also work on carbon emission reductions, carbon tax increases, and the protection of endangered species and wildlife. The minister is George Heyman, how are you doing Heyman, of Vancouver Fairview, who's worked as the executive director of Sierra Club BC, an environmental advocacy and education group. So he's definitely qualified. Let's talk issues. The economy. We've already talked about finance, forest land and natural resources, and energy, mines and petroleum. So let's get to the ministries of job, trades and technology, tourism, art and culture, and agriculture. Bruce Ralston of Surrey Wallie will be the Minister of Jobs, Trades, and Technology. He used to own his own law firm and has been on the board of directors of Van City, Surrey Memorial Hospital, and the Surrey Public Library, and is the former president of the BCNDP. In short, he's good at running organizations, which is perfect for his business-focused ministry. He'll oversee work to promote BC as the home of tech companies, startups, and workers, work alongside other ministries to negotiate softwood lumber deals with the states, cut small business tax rates, promote local hiring on government projects, and develop BC trade relations. Meanwhile, the Ministry of Tourism, Art and Culture will expand the tourism industry by marketing BC globally, ensure that BC filmmakers get a fair share of telefilm and other Canadian funding, and expand BC's film labor tax credits to include writers, which is one of the few disciplines in the film industry that BC doesn't have many jobs for right now, and build and upgrade sporting facilities and community centers. It'll be run by a newcoming MLA, Lisa Baer of Maple Ridge, Pitt Meadows, which is a riding that often switches back and forth between NDP and Liberals and one of the few ridings they won in the Fraser Valley. Appointing her to a cabinet position will definitely help with re-election. Lena Popham of Saanich South will be the Minister of Agriculture, where she'll revitalize the agricultural land reserve, support the expansion of BC food production, promote BC produce in local markets, and help make BC agriculture more efficient. As a farm owner herself, who is also the opposition critic of agriculture for her last two terms, I'm sure she'll do great here. Alright, let's move down to a human scale. Affordability and homelessness. Harry Baines from Surrey Newden will be taking on the role of Minister of Labour. He served as an elected Steelworkers Union officer for over 15 years, so he seems like a great fit. He'll be establishing a fair wage commission and raise minimum wage to $15 an hour by 2021, create a temporary foreign worker registry with the goal of protecting them from exploitation, and will update and reform employment standards and WorkSafe BC. Selena Robinson of Coquitlam-Millardville will be the Minister of Municipal Affairs and Housing, where she'll work with local governments to build and upgrade community centers, as well as affordable and student housing. She'll also be improving the Tenancy Act to further support renters, and work with the finance minister to address the speculative housing market. She's done a whole lot, including being a councillor in her own municipality, and also all of this. So she seems to know how to get stuff done. The Ministry of Social Development and Poverty Reduction will be headed by Vancouver Hastings MLA, Shane Simpson. He was the Director of Policy and Communications for Smart Growth BC, Chair of the Vancouver City Planning Commission, and Instructor of Community Economic Development at SFU. So he knows how to improve the lives of a community. His ministry will be raising income assistance and disability rates by $100 a month, will design and implement a province-wide poverty reduction strategy and homelessness action plan, and will also conduct a province-wide homelessness count. Most interestingly, to me anyway, he'll also develop a basic income pilot program that'll test the usefulness of basic income to reduce poverty and improve health and housing. Keyword there? It's just a test. If you don't support it, no need to get angry. In a related effort, Judy Darcy of New West, as head of the newly created Mental Health and Addictions Ministry, will work on increasing access to mental health care, with a focus on early prevention and youth mental health. She'll also develop an immediate response to the opioid crisis. Darcy is a longtime union leader, advocate for clean water, childcare, and public health. Meanwhile, the Ministry of Health itself will invest in more paramedics, work to reduce wait times, improve rural health services, and expand medical travel allowances, and implement an essential prescription drug program. The new minister, Adrian Dix of Vancouver Kingsway, has been an MLA since 2005, was a former leader of the NDP, and has already served as the opposition critic of health. Moving right on to the ministries of education, first off, the Ministry of Education itself, led by Rob Fleming of Victoria, Swan Lake. Their priority will be to review, adapt, and increase funding of K-12 education. They'll also provide additional funding for school supplies, upgrade schools around the province, including the reduction of portables and seismic upgrades, provide new technology and lab equipment, and implement the new First Nations history curriculum. Fleming has served two terms as a Victoria City Councillor, chairing the Finance Committee and representing the city in the Regional District, the Transit Commission, Housing Corporation, and Tourism. He was also the Opposition Critic and Research and Policy Analyst for the Ministry of Advanced Education, which is now led by Melanie Mark of Vancouver, Mount Pleasant. She'll be working to provide greater access to adult basic education and English language learning, will eliminate interest on student loans, as well as provide a $1,000 completion grant and expand STEM and forestry programs. Mark has worked with the Urban Native Youth Association and Native Court Workers Association, founded the Vancouver Aboriginal Community Policing Center, and was the National Aboriginal Coordinator of the Save the Children Canada's Sacred Lives Project. Her bio also claims that she was the first First Nations woman to serve as a BC MLA. To me, it seems like she would be the perfect minister for Indigenous Relations and Reconciliation, but I'm sure she'll do great here as well. Instead, the Minister of Indigenous Relations is Scott Fraser of Mid-Island Pacific Rim. Now, Fraser is not Aboriginal, and at first this bothered me, especially when the NDP have two elected Aboriginal MLAs. But the more I thought about it, the more it made sense. Fraser has already worked as the opposition critic to this ministry. He has experience. And it's not really fair to force either of these MLAs into this position just because they are Aboriginal, when they're capable and willing to do great work in other areas. And finally, it's the Ministry of Indigenous Relations, not representation. It's supposed to be like the link between the settler BC government and the First Nations governments, like a foreign diplomat. And it may just be better PR-wise to have someone who is willing and eager to work respectfully with First Nations governments who isn't Indigenous themselves in order to avoid conflict of interest complaints. I'm incredibly interested to hear your thoughts on this. Anyway, Fraser's duties will include working with First Nations to establish a clear, cross-government vision of reconciliation and to transform the treaty process so that they follow the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples, as well as the calls to action of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission and the Chilcotin Supreme Court decision. His ministry will also support Indigenous communities seeking to revitalize connections to their languages and provide funding and support for friendship centers. Infrastructure and services. The new Minister of Transportation and Infrastructure is Claire Trevenant from the riding of North Island, half of which is ferry dependent. Transportation is important. She spent her last term as critic of transportation in BC ferries, where she produced an important comparison review of BC ferries and Washington State ferries, and introduced a bill that would promote a shipbuilding industry in BC for BC ferries. She knows her stuff and she cares. In her role as minister, she will lead planning to address rural infrastructure needs, work to eliminate tolls on the Port Mann and Golden Ears bridges, accelerate Highway 1 upgrades to Alberta, secure more funding and support the Mayor's Council's 10-year plan for a new Patello Bridge and rapid transit, video coming soon, work with BC Transit to make public transit and handy dart improvements across the province, and create a fair approach to ride sharing alongside the Solicitor General. Whatever fair means. This Solicitor General and Minister of Public Safety is Mike Farnworth, who is also the House Leader. Like the title says, the Solicitor General is in charge of public safety. They're like the elected provincial leader of police forces, prisons, and other related things. Farnworth was a city councillor in POCO for 3 terms, and has been working in provincial government for long enough to have held cabinet positions for the NDP government in the 90s. His duties will include increasing support for police efforts to disrupt the drug trade and to take action on gang and gun violence. He'll also work to reduce domestic violence, work with First Nations to reduce the Aboriginal incarceration rate, and increase funding and support for programs that have a proven success record. His ministry will also lead the planning for the safe implementation of legalized cannabis. So, a whole lot, actually. And last but not least, Ginny Sims from Surrey Panorama will be the Minister of Citizen Services. Sims has served as the president of the BC Teachers Federation and was a critic for international cooperation, critic for immigration, and critic for employment in the federal parliament. She honestly seems a little overqualified for what seems to me to be the ministry with the fewest and least important responsibilities, but at least it's something. And that's who's who, what's what, who's what, and what's who. Special thanks for this episode goes to my patrons. Your donations are very much appreciated. And thank you all for watching. See you soon.